Hello, Heck Razor. This is Jared back again. So I'm copying attempt 3 from your code here. And let's return to post. Let's go down to a window where I can edit. Let's see here. Answer. Snippet. There we go. Okay. So, let's see here. What we don't have here is the button. I'm going to add this button real quick. Button class. Get what we call class. Oh, you know what? Here it is. I'm going to cut that out there. Paste this up here. Okay. All right. Okay, so errors on top. Okay, let's make sure jQuery is defined. We want the latest version. Run this again. Okay. Beautiful. All right, so let's take a look here at these questions. Oops, sorry. Okay, so this again is the test data. So we're going to skip that. After the document is ready, it will run the setup page function, which contains the pause button click based on. This is setup function is kind of like a wrapper for the rest of the code. So that's exactly right. This is, in fact, just a wrapper. It's just a way to make communication about what's going on a little easier. So you are correct. Well done. So here we set up a variable called button. That's true, we do here. And we set it to be the button class. Why do we put the jQuery dollar sign in front of this? Okay. This is a function. So that's part of the reason why I did this, jQuery equals to, I don't know if you remember when I did this a little while back, but this function can be called just like any other function. It can be assigned, and while it is standing on its own as just a dollar sign, it is a variable. When you add parentheses after it, or when I do setup page, this is a variable. Now I'm calling that variable as a function, okay? So what we're doing is we're calling the jQuery object as a function. Now, the jQuery object has been set up in such a way that calling it directly as a function will search the page using this argument as CSS string, or a CSX text. And using this CSS, it will select elements from the page. Okay, so the reason why we precede the CSS with, it's really kind of wrong to say that we're preceding this. We're actually calling the jQuery selector function, which is this, and we're passing in the name of our CSS into the parentheses. All right, so that's what we're doing there. And that's why the dollar sign appears there. So this is actually a function. And CSS selector, CSS selector, and this part here, this string, is the CSS that we're going to use to select the various elements on the page. Now, if the CSS applies to multiple elements, so for example, if we had two buttons that both had the start request here, okay, just like this. What jQuery returns from the selector is actually a collection of all the buttons that match this. In this case, jQuery should apply the click method to each of the contained elements. Okay, so let's run this. We should have two buttons now. And it doesn't matter which button I click, each one should now contain the same functionality. Run that again and clear it. And the reason is jQuery is returning a collection of elements with this selector. Okay, and the selector we've defined as button.startQuest. And then this method, whatever method we call on the return collection, gets applied to all of the elements of the collection. There are a few exceptions to this rule, but in general, jQuery tries to make things very easy for us by not making us treat this as an array. Okay, but in reality, it is an array. Okay, so let's get rid of that extra button there. We don't need to worry about that, and we can just leave this alone for now. Okay, so then we create a click event on our button variable to run the function here output. Yep, that is correct. I create another click event to run the function loadJSON. Yes. These two events will run asynchronously in order, one after the other, when our button. This is absolutely correct. Yes, you're right. We create a variable called outputArea and set it to be a div tag with the class of results. Yes, and for the same reason as above, we're calling the jQuery function. That's the dollar sign and the parentheses, and this is that's called the selector function. We're passing in some CSS, which will then return an array of elements that matches. Now, we use the .empty method on our output area variable to remove everything within our, yes, and keep in mind output area is actually an array of objects, which jQuery allows us to then empty each element in that array. In this case, output area contains only one item, because only one item matches. But if multiple items matched, it would apply to all of them. We create a variable called JSON-URL, store our API URL in it. Yes. Then we run the getJSON method to first request the data from our getJSON-URL, and then send the data to our addJSON-to-page function. That's the question, and yes, you are absolutely correct. So we are using this helper function to send in a URL. The function is going to call the URL, and instead of returning the results to a variable in this function, it's going to pass the results to whatever function we specify. And we specified addJSON-to-page. So you are correct. That is exactly what's happening. This is where I have my confusion, so bear with me. Not a problem. We've all been there, heck razor. It's here. I see there's a JSON results parameter, but I don't know where it came from. Is this the data from .getJSON? Yes. Yes, it is. So let's go to the jQuery API. Okay. jQuery API for getJSON. Do a little Google search, and hopefully Google will take us right there. Boom. Okay. So this is the documentation for jQuery. This is the documentation specifically for the getJSON function, which we are seeing, we are seeing that right here. Okay. So this is the instructions for how to use this method. Into this method, we pass the URL. We can pass some data if we want, and this data would be an object with a bunch of variables in it. So for example, if you wanted to, actually this is kind of fun. Let's actually just separate this for a minute. Right? And I think I can do a split screen here without ruining the video. Still recording, okay, good. Okay, so we need to keep this format. So this here is data that we're passing in, right? So, but we could just as easily say data equal to object, right? And then we put in the object the information that we are interested in. Zip equal 31023. Good morning, Val. Okay, look, that's going to have to be like this. 31023, comma, and output going to be equal to JSON. Okay. And then we can get rid of this extra bit here. Okay. So now all we have to do is set the zip in this object to whatever we're looking for, and we can call JSON URL, comma, data, and then put our return function here. So this is a great way to dynamically change the zip code here. Again, you would set this value to whatever is in your input box. But that's what this means here. So we can pass it in as a second variable. The third variable then is the success function. And here we see on the success function, the function can take three arguments, okay? The first argument is the data that's returned, and it's returned just as a plain object, so jQuery doesn't really tell you anything about how the data is going to be formatted other than the fact that it's going to be an object. The text status as a string, and the jqxhr object. Now, this is a fancy name, but when you see jqxhr, I don't know why I have trouble saying that, jqxhr, this is the actual network request object. So this is the object that represents the request that's going out. So if you want to actually have access to that directly, that's how you get access to it. So we have defined a function here, add JSON to page. Now we've taken advantage of JavaScript and the fact that we don't have to specify the other two values, but here, text status and jqxhr, okay? This is essentially, this here, is essentially this, okay? Now when we leave the second and third arguments blank on this function, JavaScript, I haven't had my coffee yet today, so you'll have to forgive me. JavaScript just kind of drops those other two arguments and says, okay, well, you don't need them. And the first argument then gets matched up to whatever we specify here. Now here, they've used the variable data, but we get to choose whatever name we want. Okay, so I can call this data, I can call it JSON results. But yes, that is exactly what's happening. So getJSON is being called using this format, and the success function is the function that gets called upon successful completion of the result, okay? And that function gets called with the data in the first argument, the text status, and this could be things like ready or pending or error in the second, and the third would be access to the actual request object. Now, the browser does have some security things in place. We talked about CORS, C-O-R-S, which prevents you from accessing data on domains that are not the domain that the website is being served from. And again, this is to protect users from hackers who might be loading script from other pages and stuff like that without their knowledge. Not so friendly to developers when we're trying to load things from other domains. But again, the way around that is to set up a backend, because as long as you're calling the same domain, for example, if we were calling to Stack Overflow from this page, the browser does not block the data. So even though we have access to the request, the browser will block access to the return data if the request is sent to a different domain. All right, so let's see here. Usually in documentation, you can come down here and find a further description of what these things are. This just says plain object or string is sent to the server with a request, but it would be nice to see kind of where some examples are of that coming back, so you can see what values you can expect. We don't have any examples here, but here's an example of getJSON being called with a name and a time. And here, this would be zip code and, in your case, zip code and output. Okay? If you're sending this as a get function, this automatically gets formatted with the question mark, name equal to John, and time equal to 2 p.m. by the getJSON function. Okay? I did not, because we're using a test function. I'm going to return this back to what it was, just so that we continue. But this is a handy little feature which you're going to use in calling your PHP implementation. So instead of writing a function that writes this as a string, what I would love for you to do is call your PHP script with just the URL to the script, and then pass the variables in as a data object on the second argument. Let jQuery do all the formatting for you. That way you don't end up with typos. Remember, if you remember earlier, you sent this to me. Question mark zip equals, and then a zip code, and question mark apple people zip, and this is incorrect formatting. The computer can't process that. So if you let JSON format it for you, it will automatically convert this into this for you, which is just really helpful. Try to lean on those tools whenever you can, okay? So this is where I have confusion, JSON parameter. Okay, so yes, we did address this. This is in fact being called from this, and this is the results being returned from this URL. We set up a variable for representative list and store our extract representative from JSON results function. No. We are storing the results from the function. Okay? So let's see here. Can I switch my screen and still keep you with me? Let's open up Magic Draw. This is a UML program. Let's get rid of some of this stuff. Let's make a new project. UML project. Magic Draw is just a diagramming software. It makes flowcharts and other things like that, specifically in universal markup language. So hopefully these pictures will help understand what's going on. Okay. Create elements. Let's create a activity element. This is going to be represent. Okay, so we're going to have an input node, the parameter node. Put that here. Edit. This is going to be, what did we call this? This was JSON results. JSON results. Type is going to be. Can I create a new object type here? Let's call it object. Okay. Java language object. Okay. So we don't know much about this result as it comes into the function, but we know it's an object. Okay. Now we have over here a function that we have called extract representative from JSON result. This function has one input. That's an output. Has one input. Okay. And it takes in a JSON object. Thankfully, we happen to have one. Type object Java. JSON and Java are very closely related, by the way, so I'm just going to call that a Java object. So we're going to receive, I don't know why I'm pointing at my screen, you can't see me point. We're going to receive this JSON results object, and we're going to pass it into the extract representative from JSON results. Now, your question was, are we storing the function, this function, into a variable? Okay. And so let's see here. If I can diagram up here. This is the function, okay, and the result that comes out. The result that comes out here, right? This is the term value. Okay. So we are not storing the function, but we are storing what gets returned from the function, this object. Okay. So we call extract representatives from JSON, which is a JSON object. This JSON object happens to have an attribute called results. Okay. So we can actually specify this a little bit more clearly. Let's see here. The object flow. So we're going to do this is called representative response. Okay. So this here, we're going to call it representative response. We're going to add all the properties, edit compartments. Okay. Elements here. Create. Let's see, this has results. This is the problem with doing the videos live, is that you change your mind on how you want to do stuff. Create element. Going to be a JSON, we're going to call this a JSON result object. Okay. Attribute. Create. And this has the results as an attribute, and the type is going to be representative. I'm making this up, by the way, representative, to represent another object. Let's create that object. Representative. These are just names to refer to JavaScript objects. Now, this representative, you know, is going to have things like a name. And that type is going to be a string. Some of the other things that have had a phone number, I think. Create phone. That was also a string. Okay. It's JSON object. Attributes. This is a representative. And it's actually an array of representatives. Let's. Good morning. How are you doing, Steph? Okay. This is a type modifier. Okay. There's many of these. Okay. So. Change type. Okay. So JSON result object comes in. And what comes out is an array of representatives. So anyway, this array of representatives is what we're storing into the variable, not the function. The function is receiving the JSON object, which to return the array of representatives, which is stored in the JSON results object. Let's see. Unfortunately, this diagram doesn't allow me to show you the context of those. Okay, so again, the representative list is now an array. It is not the function. It is the return value of the function. And the return value is equal to this. We set up a variable for representative list and store. Okay. We use dot each method, which is our loop, to run through the array of data. And the dot each method, we use representative list as the index, where all the data is stored. Okay, I think we just used the wrong word here. But yes, this is the source of the data. And we use add representative as the element where we create a function to select the data that we want from there. Okay. I don't understand the index and element are, but that is what I got from reading the jQuery documentation. Index seems to be the list of data, element seems to be the location where the data will go. Okay. All right, let's go back to a new diagram, the class diagram. Okay. Array. Representative. Array. Okay, so we have here many representatives. This is the wrong diagram. So we have here representative 1, we have here representative 2, we have here representative 3. Okay. And these here I can actually edit the components. And property slots. That we can add a great value for this. This is going to be John Smith. And then I want to create a value here. This is going to be 8.661555222. Slots. This is going to be Mary Jones. Phone number is going to be 813-555-9898. And this is going to be stats. Robert. Kayak. I think I'm spelling Kayak wrong. Anyway. A value. Put this one 601-555-1313. Okay. So here we have three representatives. Okay. Each of these representatives is stored in an array. That's the diagram I want. This array here. And we've called that array. What do we call it? We called it representative list. So we now have a variable called representative list. I'm representing that here with as an object called representing array, which is just an array which stores pointers to these objects contained within. Okay? Now, if you are accessing this array, the array needs to know which object you want to reference. So the object here needs to know if you want John Smith, Larry Jones, or Robert Kyle. The way that the object knows is you pass in what's called an index. Okay? And the index, I'm going to call it index equals 0. Close. Index equals 1. Close. Index equals 2. Okay, the index is usually a number. Sometimes it can be a string. And that does make things a little confusing. But for now, we're just going to use numbers. Numbers are the default. They really start with number 0. Okay, so the first element in your array is always referred to as number 0. So using this model, if I want John Smith, I can call representative list. And you put a square bracket here and a 0. And what this is this tells the object represented as I want the item 0. And that is equal to the representative in John Smith, which we call ref 1. Okay. Similarly, representative list 1 is equal to ref 2. Representative list 2 is equal to rep 3. Okay. So what happens is when you call the each method, it takes a look at this object and says what indexes are available. And it identifies it has index 0, index 1, and index 2. It then calls for each index. It then calls a function that you specify, and it passes in two things. It passes in the index, and it passes in the object that is associated with that index. All right, so we're no longer looking at the representative list. We're now looking at the individual representative contained within the list. And the index tells us specifically in the list where we are. Okay, sometimes that's relevant. Sometimes we want to know that we're in location 0. Or we're in location 1, or we're in location 2. In our specific case, we don't care. All we care about is this, the actual representative, himself or herself. Okay, so each uses this representative list as a source. It passes into this function two arguments. The first argument is the index, which is, again, kind of like an address. The second argument is the object found at that address. And when I say it's an address, that means with respect to this object. Okay, so this object is an array. Location 0, location is Austin Scott, location 1 is John Isaacson, location 2 is David Perdue. And it's going to pass that down. Okay? Array index and array representative. So this is not the index, this is the array. The index, the array index, is the number pointing to what slot it occupies. Okay, hopefully that makes that a little bit more clear. Sometimes I make things a bit more confusing, though, at the same time. Okay. The element seems to be the location where the data would go. Okay. Yes, the element is where the data goes. So the index is the number address of within that, that array, and the element is the data itself. Okay, we need to return this data to use it. We want to use the dot result section. There's probably more. Okay, Okay, the word would be attribute. Attribute, depending upon where you're from, you pronounce it differently. It's what this kind of like aluminum and aluminium, depending upon where you are in the world, the word is pronounced just slightly differently. But attribute, attribute, is the word that we use to describe those. Also, property is a word that we use, property and attribute. Why do we start with the parameter as a JSON object and then change to drip JSON results? Okay. So the question is, why do we call it JSON results up here and JSON object here? I'm trying to separate the concept of in and out. Each one of these functions is kind of like a box. And what goes into the box and comes out really is not related to your program so much. The more general. So this function will take any JSON object that has a results attribute. If you pass a JSON object into this method that does not have a dot results attribute, you will not get out of this little function what you expect. JSON results happens to be a JSON object. Okay? I call it JSON results because I wanted to link this conceptually to the getJSON method. So this is the result of this request. I could call it JSON object. It is a JSON object. And again, this name here, it's irrelevant. All I'm saying is that this function takes in something. I create a variable name to describe what that something is, but the variable name is really irrelevant. It could be A, B, X, Z, JSON object, JSON results. And then I do something with that object. In this case, I'm passing the object to another function. And in that function, I can call it whenever I want. Okay? So here I can call it object with results attribute. So when I change names like that, all I'm really doing is trying to make sense in my own head what it is that I expect and what it is I can return. And this helps to make the code readable for other people. It helps me understand when I come back later to edit what I was thinking at the time that I wrote the function. Let's see here. Create the variable called JSON URL, so we've already gone over that. We got here. Why do we start with the parameter as JSON object? We just covered that. I believe you were explaining this in the video, but it was a little bit hard to hear. I hope that you can hear me on this video. I didn't realize that there was audio problems. I think I'm getting lost with parameters. I seem to just not know where they come from. Array index makes sense by its name, but I don't know why it goes there or what it's doing. Same with a representative. Okay, you mentioned that you were looking at the each API document, each. There you go, each. So this takes a function, and this is why they go where they go. And you're kind of alluding to that. So element is whatever element is in the array. In this case, each of these is considered an element. The index is the descriptor, or the key that tells the array which element we want. Okay, so we get the index, which again is the number. We get the element, which is the object, and the element can look like whatever it is that we stored. In this case, we stored a whole bunch of objects that look like this. They have a name, party, state, phone, office. I've represented them here as just having a name and a phone, just for simplicity. But it has all of these things, and if I change this in any way, whatever this is what gets put into the element. Okay, so each of these is our element, and it is whatever we want it to be. So we change this, we change our elements. Okay. We set variable for this, I assume this is div tag. Okay, we set variable to get dot name, wrap it in this, set variable to get, use a pen method to add rep name to our output div, yes, and yes. Yes, that's all correct. That's all correct. This will wait for the document to load, execute our code. You are correct, yes. We do this because if the code is executed before the document is loading, nothing will exist, so the code will, that is also correct, yes. See, does this need to be the last item on the page? Okay. This actually, it depends upon which language you're in, so, and also how you're defining functions. I like to put it at the end because functions, okay, so there's something called hoisting. Okay. In JavaScript, hoisting means that if I declare a variable, okay, hoisting takes the definition of the variable up to the top of the scope. So within a function, if I declare a variable down here, variable, new variable, I can use this anywhere within the function and it will exist because the compiler moves this definition to the top. And then I can use it wherever. Same thing with function, okay? Functions are hoisted. So technically, I could put this up to the top, and all of my named functions would be read first. And for readability, sometimes that actually makes it more readable. But the problem is not all languages are hoisted, and when they are hoisted, you don't necessarily know how that impacts behavior. So I personally like to define my functions first. That way, if there's any hoisting going on in the background, I don't have to really worry about it. All of my functions are defined, and then document is called, and I know that the system is going to know what setup page is because it was defined up here, okay? And I used to program in C and C++ where there was no hoisting, so you had to define the function before you called it. So JavaScript is a little flexible with this. You don't have to have it at the last line in JavaScript. I recommend it still, just because it's good coding practice. As the decades go on, we'll see more and more things like hoisting in all languages that we use, and it will start to not matter so much. But that decision is up to you. I try to make things as easy on the compiler as I can, just because it increases speed and reliability. So no, this doesn't have to be at the end. I still recommend that you put it there because the system has no idea what setup page is until you define it. And it just helps define it first. Okay, so we haven't really changed anything. I should be able to run this and get my elements here. And in order to add some clarity here, let's add some more text here. I'm going to do element collection append. I'm going to append some text. Index. Plus array index. And then we're going to add. Oops. Element. JSON stringify. Okay, representative. Let's see if that works. Yeah. Okay. This helps us kind of peek at what's going on here. So at index 0, we're getting this as an element. This is our object. And when I call a representative.name, I'm returning Austin Scott. And when I call a representative.phone, I'm getting this phone number here. Okay, so this is just a little quick way to see what's coming in the function. By all means, use output use console, use elements to the screen to kind of inspect what variables are going where. There's a nifty little thing in Chrome called the inspector, which actually allows you to inspect. It allows you to actually set breakpoints in your code. So, for example, can I do that right here? Where is the code that injected on this little application? You know what, I can just cheat. Debugger. Okay. This command in JavaScript does nothing when this window is closed, the inspector. When the inspector is open, it forces the program to stop. So I'm going to run this to reload that. I'm going to click this. Here, check that out, that's our code, right? And I can do things like hover over the variable and see that this is a zero, and this is an object with a district, a link, a name, and each time I go through stuff, I can kind of like go line by line and see what's happening. So you can see here, I did append, you know, added index and element, and I did append representative name, you know, added offset stat. Now it's going to add 202235, right? So that's just a fun way to kind of get to know what each function is doing. By all means, play with the inspector, play with output, and you'll do just fine. If you're not